Hello, welcome to City Council Spotlight. I'm Sarah Fishman. Today we are with Mary Jo Rossetti, Councilor at Large. How are you doing?
Fantastic, thank
are
you, Sarah.
Are you cold? You look warmer than I feel.
Yeah, so. No, sun is out, so I'm happy.
You're happy. Okay. So I want to start by just talking a little bit of background. I'm new to this particular show. It's a new year. Mm-hmm. So, new name, City Council.
Yes.
Whose idea was that originally?
Bill brought it to the council, to the Board of Aldermen for consideration. Bill White.
Yes.
Who is the longest serving councilor slash alderman. And it was, you know, his opinion, especially with discussion of constituency, that, you know, let's go with the flow of the New Year's and no longer have the females of the board be considered men with aldermen, and that disappointed a lot of the population.
Which disappointed?
The fact that the females were referred to as aldermen.
Okay.
And there are very few aldermen left in the Commonwealth, or in the country, actually. Most
is
city council.
Cambridge has been city council for a long time,
yeah.
And Medford is city council.
Mm-hmm.
So
I forget, I think it's Everett or Melrose that may still use the alderman.
Right.
But we were very, very much a minority in the Commonwealth. So that went through to the state. We all unanimously agreed with Alderman White at the time. Went up to the state for permission from them. We received their granting, and so we changed our ordinance, and we are now city council and have been.
So is it a charter issue? I mean, why do you have to ask the state? Because it's a...
I believe it was part of the charter.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what? I didn't pay that much attention to the detail of it because we had so many other items on our plate that were, you know, keeping my brain going that, you know, when he mentioned it at a meeting, I thought, sure.
So did someone say something to him? Was it a constituent?
I don't know.
Okay.
I never asked him.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just curious.
Yeah. I don't remember the discussion he brought to the table when it was a couple of years back that he introduced that idea to us.
Yes. Okay, so I wanted to take this opportunity interviewing you to better understand ranked choice voting,
okay.
Which I think you have notes on, so you probably
yeah.
get better than I do, but an attempt to use some very high-tech technology here. Is this well-positioned? Can you zoom in on that? Okay, so ranked choice voting, this is something that a lot of communities use now. Instead of just voting for a single person, you express a list of preferences mm-hmm. for candidates.
Mm-hmm.
So this is how it works. Candidate A, in this case we have four candidates. Candidate A gets 475 votes, B gets 300, C gets 175, and D gets 75. No candidate has a majority, so candidate D, the lowest, all of candidates D votes are going to be redistributed dependent on second choice preferences.
Mm-hmm.
So all of the 75 people here, if 50 of the 75 voters there listed candidate A as their second choice, candidate A would receive that number. And if B received 25, mm-hmm. then those would also carry over. So what would happen is A would have 475 votes as previous, plus the 50 from candidate D's second choice, and B, 300 plus 325. A would win because A would now have a majority vote.
Right.
And so did I explain that correctly
right.
to your
the,
knowledge?
The idea is to get it from each other. A multitude of reasons that community has expressed interest in ranked choice. There are not a lot of districts that are using ranked choice, to my understanding. In Massachusetts, I think Cambridge...
They've used it for a long
yeah,
time, I think.
Right.
Yes.
But the mayor had formed this Clean and Open Elections Task Force, which convened and had quite a few meetings. They unanimously... put into part of their report was a unanimous vote by that task force that the council consider moving in this direction.
When was that? When was that?
I believe we received the report. It was in 2018. I think it was the fall of 2018. Okay. And I'm sure it's up on the web, Clean and Open Election Task Force report.
I hope that something like that is on the web.
Yeah,
it
came to us, so it would be through our meetings,
yes,
if not anywhere else. But part of it is that, you know, it would better, there has been data to prove, and Australia has used it for quite a while, California, Maine recently implemented it.
Yes, statewide, I think.
Yes. And there was concern that it would be very confusing, and how would the voters understand it? And I have learned that Maine, it wasn't as difficult as everybody thought it would be. It was more easily understood than everybody had anticipated.
Mm-hmm.
It also is a cost savings.
Yes, I was going to. So, again, in this high tech, well, I don't have to pick it up.
Yeah.
There, it eliminates the need for runoffs.
Right.
And it, well, you should say what
some
what
districts
other.
Choose not to do primaries.
Yes, correct.
So you don't have the primaries, you just have the November election. It allows more time and opportunity, especially for people abroad, to be able to cast their votes, absentee ballot voting. The only difference for increase in any cost, to my understanding, would be that they would have to print more ballots.
But comparatively, that would probably be a lot less.
A lot less if we don't do the primaries
in
September.
Did the commission have any sort of cost savings?
I don't think
it?
They dove into the numbers to my remembering. I mean, it's been over a year since I had that report.
Right.
We would have to, though, if we choose to go in that direction, we would have to send a home rule petition to the state and ask for permission to consider that. There is a community that adopted it, Amherst, I think, that adopted it by a change in their charter and a vote on the ballot by the community.
Which is interesting because the city manager of Amherst, I believe, is still Paul Bockelman.
Oh, that's right.
Who used to be on the school committee here.
Right. Totally forgot that. Yes. So I know that it had been expressed to me that that's how Amherst did it, by a referendum vote of the people and changing their charter.
Isn't there also a state petition question drive going on to put a ballot question on the next state ballot, suggesting that this be adopted statewide? I believe so.
I know that Rep Conley put forward a bill and it sort of died and sat.
But I
don't know where it sits now.
I think I had to sign. I mean, I didn't have
to. Okay, so.
But I have recently signed
one.
I believe it's at least out there
Good.
Kind of thing. Yeah.
Good.
So that would eliminate the need for individual communities to then go to the state. Because
right. If we can get Mass General Law to say it, then we don't have to do the home rule. We don't have to. We can do it municipal, locally, however. But there wasn't much discussion, to my understanding, at Beacon Hill last time that our rep put forward that bill, but now this in rep Secretary of State Galvin has opined that he is in agreement for ranked choice voting. So I think that's very helpful.
Yes, and might suggest the way the wind will blow.
Yeah.
Might.
Yeah.
So you brought up Beacon Hill. We have Denise Provo. I think sometimes people refer to her as Denise Provost, but I think it's Provo. She is announced she will not seek re-election after 15 years as state rep. Prior to that, she was alderman then at large here in Somerville.
Mm-hmm.
But you two didn't overlap, right?
No.
Because you went on the board in 2013, is that right?
I think it was, I'm just starting to serve my fourth term. Yeah, I think it was third.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Yes. So you
14,
okay. So maybe you were elected in. Yeah, okay. So do you have did you talk with her about it, or do you have any sense of what impact that'll have since she's a long-serving Somerville?
I have not. How I learned about it was I saw a post on Facebook. Somebody was sharing a message they had received, I think, an email. I assume it was an email, and they copied and pasted it onto a Facebook page of her announcement. And that's how I learned about it. I did not know. I have yet to see her, to talk with her about it, but the first thing I will do is shake her hand and thank her for her years.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the public understands how much work, time, sleepless nights, go into any form of government. And the role that she played, and she took her role very seriously.
Yes.
You could tell by listening to her in any discussion that she did her homework before she came to the table. And if she didn't have the answer or understand it fully, she would ask for more time to do that research. She did a lot of research on all of her points of concern or what constituents would raise to her. And that so much impressed me about her. And I learned a lot by watching her, because when I started serving in government, it was mostly men. And I was on the school committee for a number of years. There were a lot of men on the school committee.
You started then in...
My first year serving on school committee was 2000.
2000.
I got elected in 99, yeah.
99.
So I began in 2000. Dorothy Kelly Gay, our first woman mayor, and I was so excited to have a female at, you know, at the leadership, because, and I supported her in her run then. No disrespect to men, but it always bothered me that, you know, why can't the women be as represented as the men? Why can't we make it a 50-50 split?
Mm-hmm. You know?
So, you know, turn the clock ahead to today. We all know there's the woman movement, and women are getting elected left and right, which is really exciting, because there are a lot of men that do a lot of homework and research, but from my observations, for whatever reason, the women seem to go into more detail, finite detail. And I hope I'm not going to get beat up by my male colleagues in government, because I don't mean it disrespectfully.
Right. And in Denise's case specifically, she's also a lawyer.
Right.
So she has that sort of maybe more refined way of looking at legislative stuff.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So I've tried to do same by trying to read up on everything. You know, I have notes in front of me when you told me we may be talking about a certain amount of things, and some I wasn't so sure on, so
all
I
right,
did
what
my
were
research.
You not sure on?
The ranked choice voting.
Okay.
I knew about it. I knew the differences it would bring and the importance of bringing more diversity as the end result. But I wanted to understand, I wanted to remind myself how many communities are doing this and
right.
How did it go for them. And I learned a little bit about that in the last couple of days by more closely looking at reports.
And just to go back for a second, the other thing that it does, that it is touted as a positive for it, is that it's a way of preventing your least favorite person from being elected. My mother always said she never voted for anyone. She always voted against somebody else.
Yeah.
So if we had all the ducks, the Disney ducks, running for office, you could have your first choice be Donald, and then Huey, and Dewey, and then Louie. And if you didn't want Scrooge, then you would not list him as your first, your second, your third, your fourth
right.
choice.
And right.
therefore, if nothing else, your vote would never be allocated to Scrooge.
Right.
So that's an interesting argument that could, in theory, be raised in current times if there is an interest in removing someone from office
right.
kind of thing, just theoretically speaking.
I think we also have to determine, if we get to that point in Somerville that we do this locally, that how will we do ranked voting? Will we just say pick your top three?
Right.
Or will we say work from everybody's name that's on that ballot and rank them all?
Right.
That has to be decided too.
Mm-hmm.
People do
so
it.
What's the
communities
difference?
Do it differently.
So what's the difference?
Well, if you did just your first three, then you're really not empowering a lot of other possibilities.
Right, right. And in this most recent at-large election, the top four people were the four incumbents
yeah.
who were reelected.
Yes.
And then the fifth highest finisher was a newcomer, and the sixth highest finisher was a previous alderman. So,
right.
you know, if you were trying to push for one versus the other, then, you know, that could be more, it would depend whether you were,
right.
How many you were
many.
Choosing.
Right. So, you know, I'm sure this will continue in discussion. I'm
yes.
hopeful that it will, the Beacon Hill will see the light on this.
Right.
And then we have to discuss it locally, how exactly would we do it.
Okay. So speaking of how things get done, You are on the, this is a bad segue, but I didn't know what to say. You are on the committee that is overseeing reconstruction of the high school.
Yes.
And I know this is something really important to you. Why is it so important to you? Because all the years with the school committee?
All the years serving on school committee, I learned, so I was encouraged by, I was very active in PTA. My children were very young.
That's how you started, right?
Yes.
In the Powderhouse.
Anita Harris was the first black female elected in Somerville. She served Ward 7, where I also lived, and she made decision not to seek re-election. I think she served 3 or 4 terms, and she was a single mom. And
I remember her.
Her daughter, her daughter Sydney was at the age where Anita thought, you know, I need to be home with my daughter, because you're really not, you really are not home a lot when you're in office. So she told me first, and I thought she was just telling me to be nice out of conversation, because I was a geek that would always go to some of their subcommittee meetings because I was interested in it through PTA. I would represent PTA by listening at meetings and report back to the city's PTA group what was happening. She encouraged me to run. I ran, and so I served 7 terms. But when I served those 7 terms, I like to branch out of my own bubble and see what everybody else is doing in the world.
You were very active at the state level.
I got really involved at the state level, and I eventually became the president of the Massachusetts Association of School Committees, which allowed me to travel the country. So for 7 years, I traveled the country. I learned, I went to a lot of conferences in other states. I went to Washington 10 years in a row. Mike Capuano, I think, was sick of seeing me with, you know, me and all my colleagues at the board of directors. We would go annually.
So were you looking at, aside from D.C., were you looking at other schools, at programs for best
practice? Looking at what do other districts do, and what are their strengths, and what are their weaknesses, and how do they overcome that? Mm-hmm. And I learned a lot, and a lot of professional development. And so when I made the decision to step down from school committee in Somerville, it didn't come easy because I loved what I was doing. But at the time, most of the school committee, our children had graduated high school.
Yes.
And it bothered me that we didn't have boots on the ground anymore, and we weren't living it with homework and, you know, being in the schoolyards more. And so I didn't tell my colleagues on the school committee. I went to a PTA meeting at the West Somerville Neighborhood School and announced it there. And I announced it there because I begged someone in that room, someone of you, I said, will do this. I never thought I'd do this, and I'll help you do this. Mm-hmm. My goal was to find a parent. Male or female, I wanted a parent. And then I went to a school committee, subcommittee meeting and told my colleagues. So I found a parent, Carrie Norman, who's been serving since, and she's doing a great job.
She's wonderful.
And her 2 boys, one has graduated, the other is in high school now.
In fact, if I may interject, the son that has graduated and my son are the same age.
Ah.
So they are both now freshmen at Northeastern, both of them.
Oh, that's great.
So
I didn't know Carrie.
Yes.
People thought of Carrie and encouraged her to run, and she came to my kitchen and asked me about what it would entail, and I promised her I would mentor her however long it took, and we've become good friends as a result of it.
Well, that was a good mentoring stint there.
Yeah. I miss it terribly.
But I think it's a good point, not that you don't have to be a parent to serve on school committee. However, it's nice to at least have parent representation or understanding. Mm-hmm.
Doesn't have to be the whole board, but it has to be a majority of the board.
To have that perspective.
You know? Yes.
Right.
So
so that's
one of my prides was I advocated about, there should have been level funding, level service for all families in the minority population and the mobility. A lot of families move in and out and out and in of districts, not just Somerville, a lot of places.
Right.
And it affects the educational aspect, not only of that child that's moving a lot, but all the other children in the classroom, the teachers trying to keep education flowing, and the government doesn't follow through with the funding that the law said they should have been forming. So I made that my mission, and I went to a conference, a national conference in Chicago, and I fought tooth and nail, and by a squeaky vote, got the National School Board to make it one of their goals and their missions, to fight for the mobility population and for the wraparound services that were needed. So people said that would be an extension that you can do when you're on the Board of Aldermen, which, you know, it is.
But in terms of the budget?
Yeah.
I will see beyond the budget how you could.
school department, some people say Somerville school budget is so heavy, like why are we always giving
them? It's about a third of the budget,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, and it's a, we, Joe and Dorothy and everybody that I've been and watched since my children were born and paid more close attention to budgeting have been very good to the school budget. And other communities don't get what Somerville School District has been getting for increases consistently. Because the federal government is failing the schools with what they should be funding and not. And the teachers are doing everything in their power that they can. And one thing I say a lot is everybody, not just a parent, but everybody should have to be a substitute for a couple of weeks out of a year.
Not easy.
To understand it.
Yeah. Not easy.
Because I tried subbing when my kids were young and my husband and I were like scrapping together money. I was trying to stay home to raise the kids and we needed money, so it was just, you know, in PTA, principals would say, why don't you sub? I said, I have not qualified for to be teaching. Well, you can do it. Boy, was I humbled very quickly.
Yeah.
Very quickly.
Yeah. So back to the current physical plant of the high school.
Yes.
How is the schedule going? Is it on track? And when is it supposed to
We are still on time. We are still currently on time and on budget. It's a very close timeline right now. We have monthly meetings that are open to the public. They're held in the modulars right outside Somerville High. The educational wing of the whole educational building will be completed to open in September, this coming September.
So you think that'll still happen?
So far it is definitely on schedule. I don't want to jinx it.
Right.
We had some problems with contamination site. We had some problems unanticipated the demolition was happening with some steel needing replacement that wasn't anticipated, which set back a little bit. So although it is still on time, it is closely on time. So we're hoping that there's nothing, you know, the weather's continue to cooperate. But it is, we've had a lot of walkthroughs and it's going well. They did a walkthrough for the elected officials a couple of weeks back, so we all got to see, everybody got to see for the first time, and there was a lot of excitement through that tour. It was also videoed that is up on the web. The shsproject.org has a great website, which I had advocated for back when this working group, this committee was formed for the building committee, to have a good means of communication so the public at any time could see. So there's a camera that runs 24/7. You can see how it's, what's happening all the time. All our minutes are up. Once they're approved from the committee meeting, the minutes are posted. There's all sorts of graphs and charts and explanations of what's happening now, what was planned then. The Career Tech Ed program aspect is going to be phenomenal. There's going to be two more programs offered when the school is completed. It won't be starting this September because they need a year to have the teachers do their things in the state to monitor the certification of the two new programs that will be offered. I think it's going to be HVAC and barbering.
Now, that's interesting. So I should know this, but I don't. Is the new school going to be air conditioned?
Yes.
Okay. Because, and this
well,
is...
Well, it's going to be like a green effect air conditioned, not fully air conditioned, but... Boy, we talked about that about 2.5 years ago, and I'm trying to remember the end result.
Because this is again, the parent perspective. I thought that the modular units were not very attractive, not whatever, what have you.
Yeah.
And my son and all his friends were like, but they're air-conditioned,
yeah,
you know? So.
Yeah. It's not going to be like one air-conditioned per room. I forget the actual way the system will be working, quite honestly, because
But it'll be cool.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
The building committee visited a lot of other schools built by this architect to get ideas of what they've done and what they can do. And one area that won my heart, and I was so excited when we were able to include it in this project, is that there will be a room, my God, the word just left my mind.
Describe, we'll try to...
A lecture hall.
Oh, okay. An auditorium?
Yeah. No, we're having an auditorium.
Okay.
It's going to be a separate classroom lecture hall with stadium seating.
Oh, wow.
And
So what will that be for?
That will be for classes can combine and have a speaker come in and
see.
A multitude of classes in at the same time. Community can use it for a lot of different reasons.
That's like a college.
Yeah, it is. What school was I in? I think it was in Quincy. And as soon as we, the principal took us, was taking us around, and they opened the door, and I looked at it, and I said, are you kidding me? I thought I was on a college campus.
Right.
And then I asked him, I said, tell me, is it being used? Are the teachers using it? Mm-hmm. And he said, let me tell you what we're doing. And I said, okay. Then I turned to the architects and said, we have to. And it got hairy with the budget at different points where we've had to do some push and pull and cutbacks and things we hoped to do and we couldn't do. And this, I was begging, please don't cut.
So was there anything else you pushed for?
Yes, making use of the roofs. Sustainability.
So they're going to have gardens up there?
We're going to have an outdoor classroom.
Yes.
And I'm so happy about that. And it can be used more than just a classroom, but it's going to help with one of the career tech ed programs for the outdoor use. There's going to be two areas of outside use of this building. I tried to make it that the whole roof would be used for, but in the beginning I had a lot of pushback from a lot of people on the committee that the insurance would be too costly, kids would be, may fall off the, come on, we can make this work.
Right.
So over a lot of argumental meetings and a lot of good discussion with everybody, they worked it out that we do have a portion. It's not going to be in the very top of the roof. There's going to be a cutout in the building, and I think it's going to be at the fourth floor level, but it's gorgeous.
That's lovely.
I'm excited about it.
Right.
So
So we're going to have to wrap up soon. But
no,
we have a little more time, but I have a practical question. If you're trying to go to the library, the main branch on Highland,
yeah.
and you want to park, where do you do that now? And maybe more importantly, long term, that whole city concourse is not going to exist anymore for parking. Where are teachers going to park?
Exactly.
There was going to be an underground garage at one point. But that's not happening.
No.
Right. Okay.
This is so hard for me. When it came time for us to vote the years back, the budget of this project, the underground garage was suggested it was going to be way over budget.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't happy. I had a hard time listening to that. So the night we were expected to vote, the administration came in at my request, department heads, to assure me that there would be parking. We may not be doing it with this particular project right now, but there would be a plan, there would be a study, there would be parking. That in sustainability was a really pressure drive for me. So I was promised that there would be a study done and there would be attention given and there would be parking. The project had to go before the zoning board for a final approval before the construction could start. I went to every zoning board meeting advocating, and I befriended some neighbors, very well-educated neighbors who had huge concern about the cars now would all be parking on their side streets.
Right.
How could they have visitors? How could visiting nurses come take care of their sick parents? How could UPS trucks, there'd no place to pull over? There'll be no parking. So there is a task force working group formed as a result of my asking for it at the zoning board, who've been working for a couple of years. Adam Sweeting, who lives in the area, a former school committee person.
Walks his poodle.
Yeah.
Yes.
He serves on this task force. Deb Sawin, who's attorney by day, who I met through this process, she's on this task force. And
so it's ongoing.
It's ongoing, and it's disappointing me because what I've been told most recently, because I'm constantly asking for updates on what's happening, what will be the result. I'm told by a study group that it's been proven that there's enough spots on the street.
All right.
I disagree. I totally disagree.
All right. I hate to end on this note, but we have to end. So you're on it. You're aware of it. And thank you for updating us on it. And I still don't know where I'll park, but thank you. And so this has been City Council Spotlight with Mary Jo Rossetti. And have a good day.